Thank you all for coming tonight. Friends, colleagues, Melbourne City councillors, Melbourne City staff, students, visitors, randoms, and our live Facebook audience, a very warm welcome to this Melbourne Conversations event, Jan Gehl Stories, People, Places, and Cities. My name is Carolyn Weitzman, and I'm a professor in urban planning here at the University of Melbourne, Faculty of Architecture, Building, and Planning. I'd like to begin tonight's proceedings by acknowledging the traditional owners of the land in which the event is taking place, in this case, the land of the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation, and I pay my respect to their elders and families, past and present, as well as any Indigenous Australians in the audience tonight. And I just wanted to specifically mention that there is an equity and diversity scholarship being generously offered for the first time this year by the Department of Environment, Water, Land, and Planning to help address the critical shortage of Indigenous planners and designers in Australia. And there's further information at the door. Tonight's event, a collaboration between the University of Melbourne and the City of Melbourne, is part of the Innovative Melbourne Conversation Series. It's a forum that offers free discussions throughout the city to explore issues and topics of interest to all Melburnians. As we know, Melburnians love to come together and hang out and talk. Last night I was amongst hundreds of people at the Meyer Music Bowl for one of the MSO's free concerts, and tonight it's great to be here with hundreds of people as well. And tonight's event is kindly supported by and a part of the National Sustainable Living Festival. And I also want to take the opportunity to mention another big get-together, the Eco City World Summit, taking place here in Melbourne in July. And again, there's information at the door. So just to let you know, we're filming the event for publication on the internet, and we're broadcasting live through the Melbourne Conversation Facebook page. For the Twitterati, you will note that there is a hashtag MelbConvo. So please join in now, and your tweets will help shape the question period, especially since I've just retaught myself how to use Twitter, and I have a goal of someday being Toby Jones. And it would be great if we were trending and all of that cool stuff that social media does. Tonight, we're privileged to host the eminent Danish urban designer, Jan Gehl. I just discovered tonight that I've been saying Jan my whole life wrongly. A frequent and always welcome visitor to this city, and a person who's contributed greatly to its livability and social sustainability. Jan is a personal hero of mine. I've used his books, and I've used the human scale in almost all of my classes for many years in my teaching. I think the huge interest in this talk comes partly from Jan Gehl's eminence in this field, but also from the growing importance of his research topic. With rapid urbanization and the growth of the world's cities, there's all too often a focus on cars, not pedestrians or cyclists, glamorous architect buildings, but not the all-important life between buildings, livability, but not a recognition that we can't have livable cities on an unsustainable and unjust planet. The fact that the battle for sustainable living will be won or lost in cities is recognized by the UN's adoption of Sustainable Development Goals in 2015, and specifically Goal 11, which speaks of making cities and human settlements inclusive, safe, resilient, and sustainable. Specifically, the New Urban Agenda, which was adopted at the Habitat 3 conference last October by 35,000 participants, talks about the importance of cities which are participatory, promote civic engagement, engender a sense of belonging and ownership amongst all its inhabitants, prioritize safe, inclusive, accessible, green, and quality public spaces that are friendly for families. These qualities, participation and engagement, belonging, safety, inclusivity, are exactly what Jan's five-decade career has been about. These qualities also inform the work that both Jan and Rob, our next speaker, have tirelessly accomplished in Melbourne since the late 1980s. The revitalization of Central Melbourne is a big success, bringing new residents, new businesses, and inclusive street life admired and emulated by the rest of the world. But we also have to recognize that it's an incomplete success and learn from its flaws as well as its many achievements. First, the apartments that have sprung up in the CBD, Docklands, and South Bank have been mostly including 1 and 2 bedroom apartments geared at dinks or dual income, no kids. But good communities allow aging in place, and sometimes when two dinks love each other very much, they have a baby IRP, which is an income reduction kid. The larger apartments, as well as critical infrastructure such as public schools and childcare centers, have been lacking in central Melbourne development. There are wonderful family-friendly public spaces like the Art Space in Burrung Mar and the new Docklands Library, but much more remains to be done to avoid central Melbourne being a residential monoculture. Second, central Melbourne has to some extent become a victim of its own success. There's virtually no affordable housing found in an area blessed with excellent public transportation and services, as well as many job opportunities. The regulatory mechanisms such as inclusionary zoning have not been provided by the state government. It's important that Melbourne not become a place where poor people have nowhere to live, and their very existence, their right to seek shelter in central Melbourne, is criminalized. That's not the recipe for a pluralistic society. What that means is that we're here tonight to recognize Jan's achievements, but also to take those achievements and the values behind them forward to the next generation of challenges. It's particularly exciting to see the number of young students and activists and planners and designers in the crowd, and I hope you're inspired tonight to learn, ask questions, and then achieve your own greatness. It's now my pleasure to welcome to the microphone the Director of City Design at the City of Melbourne, Professor Rob Adams, AM. Rob is an architect and urban planner who has led the revitalization of the Melbourne city centres and surrounds. Rob will talk a little bit more about Jan's life and career, followed by a presentation from Jan, which will be followed by an audience Q&A. We plan to wrap up at 7 p.m. sharp, after which Jan will be in the foyer autographing the new book about his life and work. And with that, I turn over to Rob. Thank you, Rob.
Thanks, Caroline. Thanks very much. And thanks for the opportunity to be here. I don't intend to talk about Jan's career much because there's a book outside that has got this huge career in it. And if I was to start on the career, we would be here all night. So I do encourage you to go and actually buy the book and have a look at what he's done. Met Jan 25 years ago, and what I hadn't realized with Jan, what you think starts as a consultancy actually ends as a lifelong friendship and a lifelong involvement. It's like sending a Sputnik up above the Earth, and he is constantly beeping back information, promoting the city, and making Melbourne one of those cities that people have got to know a lot about. And I think mainly because of a lot of the work that he has done. So I want to talk a little bit about that 25-year career. We know what the 1980s were like, and Jan had been here for over the last 40 years, so he would have seen this long before the 80s, back in the 70s. And the aim was, how do you change that? And that happened in the 85, where you got both the state government and the city of Melbourne putting out strategies for the renewal of the city. The implementation of those strategies was in some part easy for the big projects. So by the time you get to 1992, and I don't know that people realize the significance of 92, but 92 you were getting South Bank opening, you were getting Swanson Street closing, and you were getting postcode 3000 commencing. But these big projects tend to look after themselves. It doesn't mean they're not controversial, but they usually have a scale that looks after themselves. The problem that we were facing is it's not the big projects that actually make cities livable. It's a whole lot of the other stuff. And there was a whole lot of that other stuff happening, and we had absolutely no idea of how to get people engaged with that, how to treat with them. And that's where Jan came into our lives. I'd love to say I had a light bulb moment and said I must speak to Jan Gehl, but in fact it was Nathan Alexander, who was on our team, came to me one day and said, Rob, we're doing all this stuff and nobody will ever know we've done it because it's in small pieces all over the city and we need to start recording it. And I said, that sounds like a hell of a good idea. How do we do that? And he said, oh, there's this guy, Jan. And I was then introduced to Jan, and as I say, that's turned into one of the most incredible friendships that I've had. Part of that friendship was going and working in his office in 2006 and at the university in Copenhagen. And Jan was turning 70, and in Denmark you retire at 70. So I was there for his retirement. And when I think about that, what a joke, retirement. In 10 years, he's mostly done more than most of us do in our career. In the last year, he's actually published 11 books around the world. So Jan and retirement somehow never coincided. So the relationship with Jan came through our first document in 1994, where he showed us how and what to measure and set a benchmark for a whole lot of the small things. And I won't run through all of them because we haven't got time. But also he put us on a comparative scale with other cities. He looked at cities around the world and said, this is how you're doing to Copenhagen or Stockholm or Perth. And with his vast knowledge of all those cities, he could actually put us onto their stages and make the comparison. And then he started to look at how we measure the intensity of use. So I suppose when I think about a successful city, what I've learned from Jan is don't go and count, cars or houses or financial measures. Go and count people. Go and count how many people are in the space and how they occupy it. And so his lesson, very much to us, is you need to in fact make people arrive, stay, and actually linger in it. And that's where he started. So that whole intensity of use and activities became part of that benchmark study we did. Simple things like public seating. We all knew you needed public seating, but in what form? Don't stick it out in the middle where people feel exposed. And intuitively you might have known that, but to have it reinforced by someone who'd been studying and talking about this really gave confidence to what was a very small team at the time. And that enabled us to actually look at how you design and deliver seating for Melbourne and to start to measure it. 10 years later, and that's not to say there was a gap of 10 years, because as I say, with Jan, he kept on popping up in between with ideas and inspiration as to what we should be doing and what other cities were doing. We got back and then did a benchmark study against the 94 study. And we had gone from looking at that and then starting to look at our comparators. And communication is one of the major things in our industry. And it's something we sometimes don't learn at university. And Jan is a master communicator, but not in some complex esoteric jargon, a very straightforward, understandable way. So when Jan says Swanson Street carries more pedestrians than Regent Street in London, that resonates. People know Regent Street, they know Swanson Street, and suddenly that has meaning. So it's saying the right thing in the right way at the right time and not trying to overcomplicate it. And those are many of the lessons we've learned along the way. Things like sidewalk cafes, you mostly can't see it from back up there, but there are two yellow dots there, and that's in the 1980s. And by the time we got to the 2004 study, we'd looked at how you put activity on the street, whether it's cafes or flower sellers or fruit sellers. And by then we had 389, and we've now got over 500 in the city. So suddenly you had this measurable criteria. Simple things like walking, use the same material. And we had started in that 85, but we didn't make enough of that proposal. So, just showing where we were back in 85 and where we'd got to by 2004 gave an indication. Many people, I suspect even some of you in the audience, will think that Melbourne always had bluestone. In actual fact, it had very, very little in the 1980s, and it's really grown from there as a requirement. So then we got the stats, and I won't read through them, but you can see the increase that had occurred over 10 years was quite spectacular. The power of that information is enormous. To be able to take that to the age, means that you get this article, not the one we got back in the 1980s. And to have a newspaper supporting what happens in a city and becoming one of your allies is just solid gold. So I could carry on all night about Jan and his friendship and his many guises. And I never knew quite what to expect the next time around. I was relating, a journo was giving him an interview today, and he was asking Jan questions, and Jan with a straight face was answering, and the journo didn't know whether he was joking or whether he was serious. And it went on for about 5 minutes, and then Jan smiled and said, okay, let's get serious now. He's got a lovely sense of humor. He's a great musician. He brings people like Henrique Penaloza to Melbourne and says, you've got to look at Melbourne. And he really is one of the great exponents of urban design. I put him absolutely alongside Jane Jacobs as one of the people who changed the way we started thinking about cities. So Jan has been to the city a great advocate, has been to our team and to many of us a great coach. And I'd like to now just welcome Jan to the stage. Jan.
That was something. Good evening, Melbourne. I see you all here. That's very comforting. It's a very moving moment for me to be back in my old university. I had my days here in 1976 and again in 78. And that was a very important period in my research career. We started something which developed quite a bit. We did the interface study. We started to take an interest in the edges, the importance of the edges to life in the cities. And we had, I had here the most fantastic 30 odd number of fantastic, enthusiastic students. And it's a great pleasure to be back in Melbourne. I've been looking around to see if there are some of the old faces around. I'm sure there are somewhere. But it's a sentimental journey indeed, Melbourne. Back in 1976, I can assure you there was nothing to write many postcards about Melbourne. Everybody warned me about going to Australia, for one, and to Melbourne especially. And they were somewhat right, but that was also the beginning of a lifelong love affair with Australia and Australians. And I came to realize that between the Australians and the Nordic mentalities, there are many similarities. We share a lot of things, and it's very interesting that the best cities in the world today are found in New Zealand and Australia and in the Nordic countries. They're the ones who make the top of the livable cities list, which I think is very interesting. These people are interested in quality of life. But now we shall see. I have got a few minutes here, and some person said 30 minutes, and I've never done anything less than 1 hour 22. So it will be, I'll do my very best. As a motive for the talk, I will talk about the 50 years from Jane Jacobs' book and from Jane Jacobs until today, where we know exactly what livable cities are, and we are always striving to get them. I will start by going back to those days around 1960, and I take that as a starting point. And I talk about the two planning paradigms which have completely dominated the planning and screwed up the planning in the last part of the 20th century, one of them being modernism. Modernism, of course, has a longer story, starts in the 20s and was rather strong in the 30s, but nothing much was built, and then came the war, and only when the city started to expand and the economy got better in the 60s, they started to roll out this new idea of modernism in a big way. Modernism was a very dramatic change from everything. The modernists, they say that everything we knew about good cities and about habitat for people must be thrown out, because now we have a completely new situation. We have modern man instead of the old guy. We have modern man, and we must have modern city planning, modern site planning, modern architecture, modern everything. Nothing could be used of all the old crap and stuff. So they threw out everything. Also, in this process, they threw out the cities, by the way. Corbusier would say that cities are bad, and what is really good is freestanding buildings. He called this the vertical garden city, because everybody could see some grass. Later on, they could only see the parking lot. But that's another story. And then we all started to build in this way. Cities were bad, streets were especially bad, parliament of the street and barricades across the street and street girls and everything with street, forget it, grass. And then we had all this new stuff. I think that at this time also when the cities expanded, it was as if the planners, city planners, could not oversee the big new areas, so they stepped up in aeroplanes and started to look at the world from 5,000 meter and looking down at the model and started to organize their objects. Here we are, yes, yes, and here. Bingo, this is a good city. And that was a completely new way of doing it, because in the old days they had the streets and squares, and when the cities were expanding, they made another house next to the previous one. So they, in small installments and along the public spaces, they expanded the human habitat. Now it was done from aeroplanes, and the pattern was more interesting than anything else. But what was at that time really happening was also that the people scale was completely forgotten and overlooked. Nobody was asked to look after this. And if you think that the city planners were doing it, they were not. They were flying up there. Were the architects doing it? No, they were not. And if you look at the architecture school, they didn't learn a thing about people. And if you think that the landscape architects would be down on their knees looking after this scale, they were not. They were looking after the plants. And no landscape architecture school ever in this period took any interest in what people were doing in their lives. But what the flowers were doing, that was very important. So this scale was completely neglected, and that was completely new to mankind. Never happened in the history of human settlements. I call this the Brasilia syndrome. Brasilia, capital of Brazil, started from fresh in 1955. It's fantastic. Flying over Brasilia, wonderful. It's an eagle. The head of the eagle is the parliament, and the ministers by ministers lying there one after the other along this big green lawn. It looks fantastic from the airplane and also from the helicopter. It's a great city. Unfortunately, down where people are, Brasilia is shit. Nobody thought that there would be any people moving about there, and how they could have a quality of life, and how it could be nice to be in Brasilia, how it could, you could be shaded from the sun or anything. And they always thought, of course, that they will have money, so all of them could have a helicopter so they could enjoy the city. But it never took place, and we have these landscapes here all over the world. Sometimes I go so far to say that if you really want something people don't like, ask some professional modernists to organize it for you. And I always think about this little bench which I found somewhere. Think about bringing your girlfriend over there and sit there on the bench and talk about what a wonderful future is awaiting you. Where you'll bring up your kids and where everybody would be happy. That was one of the planning paradigms, which really has influenced city planning in the past 50 years and still does to some extent. The next and other thing which happened, again, it took off around 1960. There was a car invasion. It started out rather sort of peacefully. This is one square in Copenhagen, 1905. People are walking all over the place. It's their square. And one Ford T has arrived, and it still is quite peaceful. Later on, there were more, and people started to run for their lives. And we have the third stage here from Moscow, actually, where the car is king, and pedestrian crossing is a place where you can train your slalom for the next Winter Olympics. So what was known about the quality for people in cities by 1960 was virtually nothing. Everything had been thrown out. And that was also the background for Jane Jacobs and her work. But I have a little quote here from Enrique Peñalosa, mayor of Bogota, 15 years ago, and now mayor again. He did great 15 years ago. I hope we can see great things again. But he will say that it's a paradox that we know so much about mountain good habitat for Siberian tigers, mountain gorillas, but only so very little about good urban habitat for Homo sapiens. That is completely true. I have been working in this area of good urban habitat for Homo sapiens now for 50 years, and I still think it's amazing so little research has been done in this particular area, and so little we know by now, after all. But that was the time when the first voice was heard from New York, from Greenwich Village, from Jane Jacobs, a journalist with one of the architectural magazines in America, in New York. And this is a long story, should be made short, but they had a fantastic, efficient traffic planner, Robert Moses, in New York, and he wanted to save New York by tearing it down. And he had the plan of having some sweet freeways going across Manhattan, then some of the redundant old areas, the Greenwich Village, Soho, Tribeca, Little Italy, Chinatown, all these redundant places could go out, and we could have some nice high-rise linking or being parallel to the freeways. Fantastic New York. He had all the plans. Then he had overlooked the fact that Jane Jacobs was living in Greenwich Village. And she started a big movement among the citizens to save New York and to combat Robert Moses. And yeah, she spent some days in prison in this fight and whatever, but she won. The Trans-Manhattan Freeway was not built. Greenwich Village was not taken down. But she put down many of her thoughts in this book, The Death and Life of Great American Cities, saying that if the planners, the modernistic planners and the motorists get their way, that will be the end of the great cities. That would be the beginning of the dead cities. That was a very famous book, and she is a grandmother, as also Caroline mentioned, she's a grandmother of this humanistic city planning, which has now been around for about 50 years. My story is woven inside this. Short story of my life, I graduated in 1960 as an architect, and I spent my years in universities in School of Architecture in the 50s, and all the time we were trained in moving objects around and making wonderful cities. Wow. And we were very enthusiastic about the new modernistic way. Wow, everything would be so much better. I rushed out of university and was about to do all these wonderful things for people, which I've learned in School of Architecture. Then I married a psychologist, and then there was a change of tone in the home. We had a lot of young architects and young psychologists coming, and all the time they kept saying, why are you architects not interested in people? Why don't they teach you anything about people in School of Architecture? And have you ever thought why it is that your professors go out 4 o'clock in the morning and take the photos for the lectures, so there will be no disturbing people in the foreground? This was not very pleasant conversations for a young architect. And actually, in my personal case, I had to go back to School of Architecture for another 40 years to try to find out what they didn't tell me in the first place. Actually, we had to find out more about how the physical environment influenced people's life and the quality of life. All this, nothing was known about, and we had to start at square one. And as the years went on, and we started to know a bit more, I started to write some of these things down, and then, to my surprise, they started to be published in funny countries and funny places, from one end to the other. There was even possible to make a little picture of my life, that there was 50 years of research and communication. What we actually looked to do was to make the people who use the city visible, so that we could start to discuss what the situation was for people. We realized that the traffic engineers were experts in making the traffic visible. They counted all the cars every year and had all kinds of models for how the cars could be happy, but we had no knowledge about how the people could be happy. We started to make people visible, and it's at a certain point, there were so many mayors and other good people who said that you can criticize. That's what an academic can. We can go all over the world and say how stupid you are. And look at how inhuman you make your cities. And I did that very much. And then they started to say, could you instead come and tell us what we shall do? That was what really started with the Australian cities, Perth, 1993, and Melbourne, 1994. And at some later point, we had to organize it in a company. And now there are 70 people working in 250 cities. There's been an explosion. And there are even some people now who are writing books about it. And that's Peter Newman from Perth and Annie Matan. Annie, we call her Annie. And why are these people in Australia writing about this funny subject? Yeah, there is a really strong link between my work and Australia. Perth was the first international overseas place I was invited to work in, not only to teach in. I taught in Perth earlier, as in Melbourne. But now, Perth was the first city which came and asked for the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth, and that was not a very pleasant truth. The Perth was called Dullsville, and for good reasons, and it was really horrible. It was modernism and motorism put together, and not a rat was steering after 5 o'clock in the evening. It was a horrible city, I would say. That was the start. And that was the start of a fantastic relationship with Australia, because after Perth, I was invited by Rob to come to Melbourne to do the same, to do a Perth in Melbourne. Of course, that was not a Perth, really. It was completely different. But it was Melbourne. But then came Adelaide, then came Melbourne again, then came Sydney, then came Brisbane, then came Hobart, Launceston, and most recently, Wollongong. So in all these years, I worked more in Australia than anywhere else, and I have loved it especially much. And that's the reason why Peter say that we shall write the story of what has been going on from this perspective, because we have seen cities like Melbourne turn around completely, but especially their perspective is City of Perth, which has turned around completely amazingly. It's almost like Melbourne, not quite, but they're striving first. Now, we know a few things about quality for people in cities, and we know how the things are interwoven. We know that if we invite, by making more streets, if we invite more cars, what happens? We have more traffic, for sure. If we make a Western distributor in a city, sort of like Melbourne, what will we have? We will have more traffic. In a time when the traffic is going down in many places, we can still get more if we really invite it. But we also know now that if we make more public spaces and more squares and parks, what will happen over 10 and 20 years? We will have more public life and more people using the city, more happiness and frolicking and everything. What happens if we make a very good bicycle system in a city? We'll have more bicyclists. So it's a matter of invitation and what we invite. All this we know now. And we've stopped by inviting more traffic because those days are over. Now we are more interested in the human sides of things. So we know not too much, but we know quite a bit. Jane Jacobs up there and some of my books down in the bottom, but we know quite a few things. Where do we use this? And what have we found out? Yeah, we found out that whatever we build has a fantastic influence on the quality of life of people. This is a quote by Churchill, "First we shape the cities, then they shape us." He never said that, but it's a quote from him which has been torn and changed, and so now it's about this. But it tells the story precisely that what you do in your life and how you live has very much to do with each other. So we know a lot about city planning and quality of life. And when it comes to detail, and that maybe is one of the most important things, that it's really in the detail that the battle for quality for people are won or lost. And if we look at some of the world's most famous and well-functioning squares, like this one in Siena, Campo in Siena, and we can look at it. It's been there for 700 years. It works fantastically today. It always worked. And we can ask, is it a miracle or could it be common sense? Then over the years in all this research, we made this little list of 12 quality criteria. And that is to be found in all these various books. So only to say that somebody is that you should be protected against the things you doesn't like. And when you are protected, you can start to enjoy. And you need comfort to do the things you want to do, walking, sitting, standing, talking, seeing, whatever, playing, unfolding. And then, of course, it's important that it is a good human scale, that you can enjoy the part of climate you like. And also, it's important that all this is done in a fantastic aesthetic, architectural framework, that you have nice sense experiences, details, materials, water, trees, whatever. But only if all these things work together, the thing starts to be fantastic. And then if you go back to Campo in Siena and take this list along, you go around, and for each of these things, you say, wow, yeah, yeah, absolutely. And when you come down to this about architecture and design and materials and quality, then you have an even bigger wow. And you realize that it's world famous because it's so seldom that all these things come together in the same place in a convincing way. These are some of the things we have found out. So we've also seen now with the knowledge we have and with the change of society situation, with change of economy, change of demography, whatever, that we have by now a distinct change in planning paradigms for the cities. Today we want livable, sustainable cities with invites for a healthy lifestyle. And every mayor I ever met now would say, oh, that is my program. That's exactly what I'm after. Livable, sustainable, healthy. The livable, lively, livable. Already Jane Jacobs talked about the death and the life of cities. The life is something which is very dear to Homo sapiens. Man, people, is the most interesting thing in our lives. Meeting our fellow men is very exciting. It's got a lot of qualities. We are social animal. And we always met, and the biggest interest, the biggest attraction in cities are other people. And also there is an element that if you meet other people regularly, face to face, in your shared public spaces, you come to know your neighborhood, your society, and it's very good for the social inclusion. And of course, it's very good for democracy. So it's something about having a gated community or gated cities, or having open cities where people can meet each other face to face and not sit isolated and just write texts to each other or look at pictures of each other. Still today, and we can see that even in the time when all the digital stuff is going, and some people have all the time been saying that cyberspace will now make public space redundant. We have seen in the very same period that this has developed, we have seen that good public spaces in any part of the world, they are increasingly popular, and people are sick and tired of sitting and looking at all these Facebooks and pictures, and they need also to have a chance to meet each other directly, use their own senses, having things which are not pre-programmed. So the cities are actually having a good time, and the citizens are having a good time if we can provide the quality. We also have much more leisure time today. We live much longer. There's easily time for everything. We have come to know that much of the challenge to the climate comes from the cities, and we will have to do something in the cities if we are ever to do something with the climate challenge. And of course, we realize and know that the more we walk or bicycle, the better. But also, it's evident that if we are to get rid of the cars, which we are, then we will have to develop really smart technology for mobility based on some shared solutions. And then good public transportation and good public realm, they are brothers and sisters. We have a new driver in this urge towards making more people-friendly cities. That is the sitting syndrome. And my daughter she's a senior doctor, and I've talked with her and some of her colleagues many times, and they talk very much about the sitting syndrome, which is a major problem now. It's like smoking in the old days. Now they talk about the people die of sitting. And they've also found out that, of course, that if you live in suburbs, you're more likely to die of sitting than if you live in cities, because you use your own muscles more in cities. And they found out all this about that if you do moderate exercise or activity 1 hour a day, you can have 7 extra years of life. They've also figured out that 1 hour a day amounts to 2 years, and you gain 7 years. So there's a benefit of 5 years in this thing if you walk every day for an hour or bicycle. And we've also realized that we have made cities which created people to have sitting syndrome, that we've done enormously many places where you're not invited to use your own muscles at all. You have to take the escalator to the fitness center. And it was believed that everybody would be sensitive that they will do this. And it's been found that only a small proportion do it regularly, and some people do it in intervals. But certainly, there are so many people who are not doing it And this now we have the World Health Organization saying to the whole world, make your cities so that people walk and bike regularly during the daily day activities. So we have new songs on the agenda here, which are changing the program for the cities. And if we look again on these three things of the new paradigm, you realize that if we look carefully after people in city planning, we actually address all three issues. Cities will be more livable, more sustainable, and more healthy. So we know quite a few things now. And what are we using these things for? Yes, we are using them very much to improve the existing cities. The old stuff, which was made before the automobile, which was actually made for people but had been overrun by automobiles, and now we can clean them up. Oh, we are good at that. We have cities now who invite people to walk and bicycle. I shall invite you to one of them, which I happen to know very well. That's Copenhagen. They've been urged now for 55 years since they started to close the first street and push the cars back there. And they've done every year a little bit, and they got more and more wild in this direction. In 1962, that was the same period as Jane Jacob wrote over in New York, but nothing happened in New York except they prevented a freeway. In this place here, they actually pushed the cars out of Main Street. Everybody was skeptical, can never work, we are Danes, the weather is too cold, we are not Italians, we'll never come out, we'll never promenade, we'll never... Then they did it anyway, and next year we started to be Italians, and we become more and more Italians now in 55 years, and also we realize we have fewer months to be Italians, so we are more effective with our Italianism when the summer comes out. We have two seasons, the good season and the other season where we wait for the good season. But that's another story. It started to work. Copenhagen became the first city in the world where the life of the city was studied and documented and made available to the city planners and the politicians. And we have here an interesting story about collaboration between town and gown. And when Copenhagen had been doing so well and are now famous for being a very nice city, it has very much to do that it was in Copenhagen, one of the centers for studying people in cities was created and had worked for 50 years. There's been a lot Denmark is small, lines of communication are narrow, and so whenever we did something in university, they knew in City Hall right away. And when I retired, I got this nice letter from the mayor saying that if you guys in university had not documented the life of the city so carefully over all these years, we politicians would never have dared to make Copenhagen the most livable city in the world. So they could see a combination. This is where we started in Copenhagen, 62, one street, 1 kilometer long. This is how the situation is by now. All these places have been addressed and made better for people, and cars have been pushed aside. They are still allowed many places, but they have to behave, and they all this stuff. We can see also all these public spaces are changing with the change of society. The first phase in the 60s and 70s was merely to get the cars out and give people room so they could walk. And that was also when Bourke Street was made here and little malls here and there and there. That was to make the businessmen happy so that their customers was not run over. The next phase, the next 20 years, that was, then it started to be a more joyful agenda. That was about having a good time in the city, not only not being killed by cars, but actually, and you could not walk forever, you needed to sit. And we saw the spreading of the cappuccino culture, we saw the benches come out, we saw the culture invading the public spaces. The more there was room in the city for cultural events, the more fantastic events we cooked up, and we can see this starting really to grow with more leisure time, better economy. Also, tourism started in earnest, and tourists, they doesn't walk all day. They have to sit from time to time. And also, the people of the various nations in the Western world, at least, they've started being tourists themselves. They've seen nice places. They wanted their own places also to be nice. And sitting, having cappuccino was the sign of leisure time and frolicking. So we saw all this. I remember in the 70s when I was down here, I asked somebody, why are there no sidewalk cafes in Melbourne? And some people told me, you must be crazy. We can never have sidewalk cafe in this climate. You know, it can change from minute to minute in Melbourne. Can never be. Now you have 15,000 seats in Melbourne. You are one of the most cappuccino crazy cities in the world. And I've seen this happen. I've seen one of the biggest outdoor cafes I ever saw is in Iceland. They haven't had so much money for coffee lately, but they have the cafe anyway. I've seen it in Greenland between the ice and snow. They were sitting there looking at each other and enjoying being in the public space, doing something and looking at people. Now we're in the third phase, where actually it's more and more about also being inviting for activity, for swimming in the harbor, for bicycling, for roller skating, whatever. In Copenhagen, they've been through all this, and we can see clearly that these follow the developments in society and the concerns in society now. There's more about this activity. Copenhagen has taken the next step and has made a strategy for the city saying we will be the best city in the world for people. And it's about you should walk more, you should spend more time in public space, you should, it's good for the climate, it's good for yourself. But first and foremost, the more we want you to come out of your privatized world, we want you to participate, we want you, it's good for social inclusion, it's good for democracy. So come out and participate, meet your fellow citizens eye to eye. This is their official policy. And it's not about making the city center charming and expensive. It's about making the whole city a nice place for people. And one of the examples of this is that they close all the narrows. No, they don't close them. They take the sidewalks across all the narrow streets so that the major streets sidewalk go through, bicycle lanes go through. That means that my little grandchild, Laura, of 7, she can now walk to school because early on she had 4 streets to cross, and you cannot do that as 7-year-old. Now she can stay on the sidewalk all the way to school, and the Mercedes Benzes will have to go over sidewalks. That's a completely different story of having a 7-year-old crossing a street. Also in Copenhagen, and I'll not talk about it. Now we start to, I'll not talk about that. We've started in a big way of celebrating bicycling. It started really during the oil crisis in the 70s when they had been looking at bicycles to get rid of them because they were run over by the cars, and to have lower accident rates, let's get rid of the bicycles, then they won't be killed. But then came the oil crisis. They say maybe it's not so clever, maybe we should rather celebrate them and give them safe conditions. They have got safe conditions now, and we've seen bicycling take off like this. And one of the major problems in Copenhagen today is awful congestion on the bicycle lanes. And so now they are widening them. They are taking more lanes from the parking, more lanes from the cars. All this is very good because there can be 5 times more people on a bike lane than there can in a car lane. So if you can have enough bicycles, it's good transport economy. They are doing all this. And now we are up to 45% of everybody commuting in Copenhagen. They arrive on their bicycles. And these bicycles are all over. And they create, of course, a very lively city and a very humane city, because these are people, you can see their faces, And if a street is full of bicyclists, it's not full of traffic, it's full of people, but it's a little bit fast pedestrians, these ones. You have to be a little bit careful. But if there are enough bicyclists, they only also bicycle slower. And it's so good because if you can get the grandmothers and grandfathers on the bikes and the little kids, then everybody has to go slower. And we get rid of these Tour de France people doing 40 kilometers. We are pedaling in Copenhagen. We are not doing Tour de France in a small way. Then we can talk about Melbourne, but of course I will not. I was in Sydney yesterday and days before, and they said, don't talk about too much about Melbourne. I decided not to talk too much about Sydney here. But I'm not talking much about Melbourne because Rob already has talked. And of course, we knew about Melbourne in the 70s, I remember. Melbourne in the 80s, we have this wonderful little piece, which I got from Rob, of course, the donut, it was called. And now all these fantastic things have happened to Melbourne. And I would go around the world and say, Melbourne, that's by far the best city in the Southern Hemisphere. And it is very much have the ambience of Paris, but the weather is better. I will go to a nice place like Montevideo in Uruguay with a wonderful coast and palm trees and everything and say, why is it Melbourne, which is the most livable city in the Southern Hemisphere? Why couldn't it be you? And they also, they have to do something with the cars. They haven't come around to do that. So it's Melbourne. It's like Paris, but the weather is better. And also, you have started also, and I'm, of course, very happy that part of your system, as much as possible, is the Copenhagen Way, where the bicyclists are protected by the parked cars instead of asked to protect the parked cars. This is much better for safety. And we know that safety is so important for bicycle culture because then the children can bike, then the parents can bike with three children on a bicycle, and then we old guys can bicycle. It's completely different if it's a safe system, and this is an important part of having a safe system. You're doing it. But I'll not talk about Melbourne. But always when I talk about Melbourne in other countries, I will end up by saying, if you're in doubt of what to do, here is what to do. And of course, you are just about perfect in Melbourne. Or there may be a few things which can still be fixed. Good luck, Rob, or whoever. Then I promise not to speak about Sydney. I will not. Sydney is very famous for its Olympics and its parties. But frankly speaking, when you come to the city center, there's not much to write postcards about. I have been up working with Sydney now for 10 years. We made the same study as we did here, but we were retained in the city, got a contract, 4 years, 4 years, 4 years, to come back every 3 months and kick them in the ass to get something going. I worked hard to get the buses out of George Street, and by golly, we are there now. Took 10 years. And that things will happen, and I'm not going to talk about that. I'm not going to talk about New York either. But of course, in New York, they heard what has happened in Melbourne. And this is Michael Bloomberg. And he was the one who stood up and said, I will make New York the most sustainable metropole in the world in no time to speak of. That means in my tenure as mayor. And he did a lot of stuff. He said, we can bicycle here, it's flat, it's concentrated, streets are wide. We just have to make a bicycle network. And he did a number of things to get the commuters out of their cars and out of Manhattan. It's not official, but he got a lot of inspiration from Copenhagen and from Melbourne. Actually, Rob was on our team to advise New York in their big turnaround. And they were not happy about this inspiration from Copenhagen, because you could not come to the Big Apple and say, we were very inspired from puny little European cities. But I know that they were. They specifically asked me to stay well away from any of the openings, because I could mention that we were doing this for mankind. And that was not the point. They could get through with all these things because they said that will be a smoother traffic situation. So they closed Times Square. They closed Broadway. They realized they didn't need Broadway for the traffic. And then this was Broadway in the morning of 2009. And this was Broadway a little bit later of that day. And the mayor said, it's an experiment. And half a year later, he came back and said, no, it's not an experiment. It's the biggest success in newer planning history in the United States. And they have now made 50 squares like this. All the asphalt has been taken from the cars and given to the life in New York, and it's very intensively used. They have been so happy about this idea of recreation in the city that the New Yorker is suggesting the next stage, and Jane Jacobs, she's jiggling, I'm sure, somewhere, to see that 50 years later, these ideas were back. Then I went at a conference in Montreal and talked about all these studies about Melbourne and about Copenhagen, about New York. And then this little man came galloping up to me and said, I'm the deputy mayor of Moscow. Couldn't you come and humanize Moscow? You can have 12 months, but we need to do it fast. When can you come? Monday. Then we went to Moscow in 2011 and 12, winter there, and was I shocked? I've never seen anything like that. It was completely swamped by motor cars. Freedom from communism was the right to park wherever you liked. And given that over a period of time, it has completely taken over. There was hardly room for anything. This is a nice neighborhood street, really cozy little one. This is Main Street, Moscow. Because they had a shortage of parking, they realized they could park on the sidewalk of Main Street, Moscow. And then, of course, they had icicles on the houses, so there were 90 centimeters left for the population of Moscow to go up and down Main Street. It was not glorious. It certainly was not. And then they say, how many books have you written? We'll publish them all in Russian. And then in 3 months, they had three of the books ready. They're published by City of Moscow. The worried guy on the picture is the Danish ambassador. Then we were commissioned to do a Melbourne study on Moscow. It was very easy because there was very little life left to study. So it was a very thin book. It was a very thin book, but we published it. We did this study, and that was to find out what has happened to Moscow and how Moscow was functioning at this point in 2013. Already while we were at it, I was invited up to the big man, Mr. Sobyanin, the mayor of Moscow, and he would say, what will be in the report? I said, yeah. Parking on Main Street, sidewalks on Main Street, Moscow is not the greatest idea I ever saw. And the people have a very bad time there. And that will be in my book that they should be looked after. 2 months later, I went to Moscow. There were no cars parked on the sidewalks. They have very efficient democracy. And then you realize that maybe they forget about the new rules. But then Mayor has this little car which goes up and down all the time on Main Street, Moscow. And whoever forgets will never forget it, because the car is taken away, and I don't know to where, but I think it could be Siberia. And you don't know exactly if it comes back from there. Very efficient. And then we can, then a year and a half later, I could take a picture like this one. I call this the miracle of Moscow. A year and a half later, there were no cars parked on the sidewalk. Instead, there were continuous rows of benches and planters. The gray street was becoming green. Just recently, I saw it's still much more greener now. All the advertisements in the air has come down, has disappeared, and now you can see Kremlin in the distance. It's completely miraculous. And then came the Crimean War and the Ukraine situation, and there were for 2.5 years we had no contact with them because European Union and Russia was not really talking for good reasons, and they didn't talk to us either. Then I was back again, and then I saw that while this period has been there, they have just taken our recommendations and carried them out one after the other after the other, and the city was completely changed. They had parking rules, not very popular, but they had parking rules. I told the mayor that without parking rules, you could never have a civilized city. So they have parking rules. Some car owners doesn't like me so much, but the city is so much better. And it's almost a miracle. And it's 5 years ago. And just 2 weeks ago, I was over in Moscow again. And the mayor called me up and said, could you, now it's 5 years since we made the first study, could you make another Melbourne study for us? But not 10 years later, but only 5 years later. I want it fast. And please remember to realize that we are also putting in bicycle lanes over all over the place. Miracle or miracle. Here we have the mayor of Moscow now. He goes around and talks about the importance of having livable cities in the 21st century. And the mayor of Vilnius, he's taking up the message and goes around until his citizens don't park in my bicycle lanes. Efficient democracy. So now we could stop, and actually the organizers want us to stop. And we could sort of say 50 years after Jane Jacobs, we really have seen a number of cities in all parts of the world really turn around. We are in one of the cities who have turned the most and the quickest, and it's a wonderful thing. And then I think I'll just end by saying I've showed what we can do with all these tools, with Jane Jacobs and all these books and knowledge about people and quality for people. What can we do? But I think it's important to notice also what we are not using these tools for. We can clean up the existing cities and make them much more people friendly, because behind us we have the citizens who demand quality. But when you look at what the architects, the planners, developers, real estate guys, and whatever do with the new stuff, you realize that all this knowledge about humanistic city planning is hardly used, except in the old cities where we are cleaning up after the cars. In the office, we have a project of making a book called Great New Towns of the 21st Century. It's the thinnest book you ever saw. We've been looking all over the world for fine new towns, and there are hardly any. And I think that is really a challenge. All my books are published in Chinese, and I'm very proud of this. And they are widely distributed because I've signed most of them. What really is worrying for an elderly guy, man like me is that they've not had time to read them yet. So we have to wait. People never liked this kind of city planning. They never liked this kind of development. And still we can see that outside the existing cities, modernism is certainly not dead and buried. And it's still going on with all this from 5,000 meters planning, whatever. We can go to Dubai and see a perfect Corbusier city. And we can also see again the bird sheet architects are flying over and dropping their towers randomly. And by dropping towers, you don't get a people-friendly city, you get a collection of silly towers. So Dubai is, to me, a fantastic combination of modernism and motorism. And I can ask, there's a little man standing there worrying about how to get across the street. He was never meant to. And I can ask, is this what we can do for mankind in 2017? We can go to part of Singapore and again see modernism and motorism, and we can ask, is this what we can do? We can go to the suburbs of Moscow and see the latest things they're doing, motorism and modernism, and a little man here, he is taking his chance going across. But is this what we can do? We can go to other suburbs here or there, and we can ask the question again and again. A few months ago, I saw in Serbia this fantastic new development on the waterfront of Belgrade, made by some Dubai developers. Little Dubai in Serbia. Is this what we can do for mankind in 2017? Here's a slum clearance from Mumbai in India. Is this really what we can do and shall do for mankind this time in history? And we can look at the details and say, is this really what they deserve in London by Norman Foster? Is this really what kind of bench they deserve in Lille by Rem Koolhaas? And then we can remember that while all these people cannot make people-friendly places, there are some people who can. One of them would be all the owners of restaurants and bars in the world. They know exactly how to make cozy places. If they don't do, they cannot sell their cappuccino. So we can see fantastic work with a little scale done by this group of people. We can see people who are making tourist hotels, making wonderful people landscapes, or where we'll have no people coming and swim in their lakes in these places. We can see the amusement parks all over the world. They look crap from the airplane, but down between the places, it's absolutely perfect for people. That's why people pay $30 to get into these places, being the Tivoli Gardens or Disneylands. Well, they know exactly what they're doing. But when we are doing new towns for mankind, we have a great problem. There are a few examples, and I have no time to show it, but there are examples of places which are just great and just newly built, one of them being BO01 in the harbor of Malmö, Sweden. It's the best housing area in Copenhagen. It's just across in Sweden. And then if we take my little list of qualities and go to such a place, we suddenly realize it's not magic. It's not a coincidence. It is very systematic work for the quality of places. Now we are almost there. But I will end by giving you a ray of hope. This is Peter Newman from Curtin in Perth. He did a TED talk. Go and see it on the internet. And in this one, he said, it's called, Are We Winning? Yes, we are. He said, car driving has stopped. In the United States, they are down to the level of 20 years ago. In Australia, all the cities in Australia, the car driving is down. Canberra is latest because they've been more sitting syndrome up there. But all the other ones, we have seen the same slump. And he also tells us that public transportation is up all over the world. especially in Asia and Europe. And before this change, the predictions for all the bad things you can think about was not very good. But after this peak, the predictions are much better. So Peter will tell us that we are winning. Welcome to the 21st century. Thank you.
Thank you, Jan. That was marvelous and inspiring, and now we get to do our little Q&A. Do you mind sitting there? No, no, you're not allowed to sit down yet. So my Toby Jones fantasy, he is a moderator in Australia, is coming true. We are trending on Twitter. And most of the questions have to do with, why are you so awesome? And also, do we pronounce your name Jan or Jan? But there was a very good question from Lauren Graham asking whether how we can improve walkability and cycling outside the center city in some of our outer suburbs. And I thought I would start there while other people think of questions.
We have in the inner suburbs, they were actually made for people and before the car. And they generally have a scale which lends itself wonderfully for walking. They're also very interesting to walk around in. If there's short enough between the changes of scene, it becomes interesting to walk, bicycle, and they're good. The outer suburbs, they are made for the car, and they have a completely other rhythm. And some of the things which went wrong with the modernism and the motorism was that with the modernism, we started to have completely different scale, and over time, all the architects and planners completely got confused about scale. What is human scale? Nobody knows. And the cars further confused us, because 5 kilometers an hour architecture is one thing, 60 kilometers is another thing. And out there in the suburbs, we have 60 kilometer an hour scale throughout. Very boring to move about. You can walk for a kilometer and you are still looking for something interesting to look at. So it is something about the scale. And that's also why all these schemes are about to intensify the density to make human scale appear, take some of it down, make human scale, so say some can, and then we can have close by something which is interesting. But it's really a problem that we made so much based on cheap petroleum, because we cannot go on having cheap petroleum as a major idea of planning. And we have to get rid of the sitting syndrome.
But not for the next 5 minutes. We have two people with microphones circulating, and we have a hand right over there. And so the question's about isolation, and how do you overcome that kind of social isolation, Nan?
I think that indirectly I have tried to answer exactly that question. That also in Copenhagen, every other household in the city of Copenhagen is one person. And that, of course, we have the smaller and smaller households, and we live longer and longer, and there's more and more isolation. We have more and more stimuli and digital stuff. Mm-hmm. But we need to have contact with other human beings. And it's always throughout the history of human settlements, the public space where the citizens meet. It's the lowest kind of meeting. That's just sitting there, seeing them, hearing them, feeling that you are part of the crowd. The next step could be that you make some friends there, whatever, or meet your friend, whatever. But just being there is the lowest level, but it's a very important level. And if you don't have that, you're really poor. And that's why we make these these policies of being better for people, inviting people to come out and having good spaces and places where they can go.
So it was a question about public housing, social
and the quality of the outdoor spaces. But I think that was part of what I talked about in the end, that there are so much stuff being done with no concern for good quality people spaces. And there always have been made these lousy buildings and housing areas. And we have to do much better. We know what to do. We can do. And it's so cheap to do it. Mm-hmm. It's the cheapest thing we can do. That is making infrastructure for people and bicyclists.
Thank you. And now we'll go to the question from that gentleman over there.
Yeah. My name is Jeff Robinson. An observation and a question. The first observation is I had the pleasure of visiting Copenhagen in January, and cycling around it was really joyful. And the observation is you must have banned Lycra in Copenhagen, because there wasn't anyone wearing it, and the people who were cycling the bikes, they were on fixies, and it was, you sat up and you cycled around like this, and there wasn't any aggression. And that's fantastic. I really like that, and I wish we had more of that in Melbourne. But my question is relates to after Copenhagen, I traveled to Dubai, and I spent 2 weeks there. And my question is around, can you retrofit a city for people like Dubai? I think you can, but you've got to start at a smaller scale and tie it around transport and things like that. But I just wondered, everyone says, oh, it's too hot, you can't go around, and I think you can with shade, and I'd like your views.
Yeah, I would rather not talk about Dubai, but talk about retrofitting, because there are so many places where actually it is possible to bring in the human scale, to bring in the invitation for people to come out and for them to walk and bicycle, as World Health Organization asks them to do. And there are many examples around the world of retrofitting existing stuff. And Dubai is just another modernistic area. And there are so many modernistic housing areas around the world. I think you mentioned some of them here. There are good examples also of retrofitting, and it's something about scaling it down and bringing in the human scale by parachute and analyzing the situation properly with human eyes at eye level instead of flying about over there. That's what I can say.
Great. And can I just remind people, if they can, get up and use the mic so I don't have to repeat the questions. Thank you, Jeff. Question for you, sir.
Yes. Cities around the world are facing huge dilemmas in housing, affordable housing for the homeless and for low income. How do you see cities kind of adapting to those challenges, or what are being done in places like Copenhagen, New York, here, and what do you think can be done better?
That is a good question. In Copenhagen, which I know well, we are increasingly seeing the problem that the Copenhagen is now absolutely wonderful. Sorry about that, it is. And in the existing market economy, that means that people will, for God's sake, don't leave the city and go to the suburbs. And people in the suburbs will certainly, if they can, try to go into the city, where all the services is, and it's a nice and people-friendly city. So the prices of all the residences are going up. And this is something we talk much about. And of course, I've been reproached because I have participated in making the city so nice that poor people cannot live in the city. So the answer is to make the cities very bad, and we will not have this problem. That is not the answer. The answer is that we shall make sure that much, much more places, many, many more places, have these very basic qualities, which are very cheap to introduce. It's mostly about thinking and compassion. that's one thing. And the other thing is, it's not the designers who shall make things bad, because all this comes from the market economy, and it is the politicians who can do a lot to relieve this situation. Like in Copenhagen, where they have this rule that 25% of everything new has to be affordable, whether you are a developer of social housing or whatever, you must apply to this rule that 25% should be accessible to lower incomes. I think that's, it's a very important discussion, because if we make things better in the market economy, it gets more expensive. So we may have to make many more things better. I'll not accept not to make things as good as we can.
Thank you, Jan. That was a great answer. Our lucky last question comes from that lady who was going to have to
pick the microphone. How are you? It's a very short question. I only want to ask you, what is the level of public participation that should be provided in decision-making process, especially in Metro Melbourne Rail, for example?
In what?
The level of public participation.
The level of public participation.
There was a reference to a community engagement, overhead rail lines that are being discussed, but the main question was, what's the level of public participation that fits in best with your ideas?
Yeah, we've seen quite a few things from this very efficient democracy we have in certain parts of the world to a very careful democracy which they have in Sydney, where they discuss so much that nothing really has happened for 10 years. And that is bickering between the state and the city, and that's something which is an Australian speciality. And there's a lot of participation there. But I do think it's very important to have participation, to make the stake, to have the stakeholders have their say. But it is my very strong opinion that we as professionals should be very professional in this discussion with the stakeholders and the citizens, and that we shall make sure that they are well informed, that they know that they are being told what they can choose from. Because if they are not, if you go to the dentist and she will start to say, yeah, I can do this, I can do that, I can do that, and I can do that, what would you like? Then you get worried. And as a good professional, you should see, I recommend this, and I'll show you these examples from other cities where they have chosen something like this, and also some of the other things, so you know what you have, what are the options. You can never ask for something you have not heard about or seen, and it's very important that we make these best practice known as part of the public process. But the public process is extremely important, and there's nothing people are more interested in than city planning and the quality of the neighborhoods and the city, and that we shall cherish that and do that, and we shall be professionals and provide the information for the discussion. Or they just say, we want more parking spaces, and we want, and they will always say, we want more trees, because they know about trees and parking spaces. But there are other options and other combinations, and we have, and that is very much what I've been doing in my career, to make books showing what they're doing in other places and as inspiration for an informed public debate.
Thank you, Jan. Now, it is Jan, right? You weren't just fooling me. We'll never know. Okay. I have one more pleasurable duty to do, which is to thank you all for coming and asking excellent questions. Thank you to Melbourne Conversations and Jeffrey. Thank you to the Melbourne School of Design, the National Sustainable Living Festival. Thank you to our own Rob Adams. And above all, thank you to the magnificent Jan Gehl. Can we have a round of applause, please?